Your Honor, I'd like to, my name is Mark Dan. I'm in police court. I represent Catherine Russell. And I would ask the court for 5 minutes for rebuttal, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honors. As a preliminary matter, I'd ask the court to consider striking the notice of supplemental authority that was filed yesterday, or that we be given leave to respond to the misleading representations in the holdings of the holdings in the cases therein. For example, there's absolutely no reason to submit a supplemental authority Ninth District case law that this court just decided. And the only reason I can think of to do that would be to offer a kind of an unopposed opinion as to what those cases mean. And I think that if the court's going to consider that supplemental authority, they would at least, well, clearly the cases exist and they have to be considered, but give us the opportunity to respond.
Counsel, I was going to say, obviously we look at any cases that are on point, whether they're cited in the appellant or the appellee's brief or not.
Right.
But when there are supposed to be, under our local rule, just cases that are presented to the court for supplemental authority, there's not supposed to be any argument. So I will give you 7 days to respond to that.
Thank you, Your Honor. I appreciate that. And just
not a whole new brief.
No, you're right.
Just
as much as I would like that.
Just responding to those cases, and that's it.
I appreciate that.
Thank you.
In fact, the Supreme Court's decision in the Holden case cited by that supplemental authority supports our position that proof in a foreclosure case requires proof of the right to enforce the note. While standing doesn't necessarily require the right to be able to show the right to enforce the note to get in the courthouse door, and we've been through that argument here and then up in the Supreme Court, it is required, the ability to afford the right, proving the right to enforce the note under the Holden decision, which is the latest Supreme Court decision on these types of issues, still makes it clear that that's a required element of proof in the case. The second kind of unusual matter I'd like the court to consider is the fact that this may still not be a final appealable order. The court below entertained a motion to add a party and then an amended complaint, which was filed by the appellee in this case. We filed a proposed answer to the amended complaint, which on motion of the appellee was stricken. It's our position that this is not a final appealable order because that amended complaint opened the door to raising appropriate affirmative defenses and required that for all elements alleged in the amended complaint, even those that may have been decided previously, that there be due process of law and some opportunity. And I think even if it's not identified in our brief, I think it's plain error that this court could identify and send this back down to Judge Gallagher to resolve the issues of the, to allow our answer to be filed to the amended complaint, and then to allow proof to go forward, whether by motion practice or through trial in the case. Because the order appealed from if it is appealable, would be the first appealable order in the case, raising the issues that we raised in our brief regarding the evidence that was relied upon on summary judgment, even if it was unopposed, to grant summary judgment in favor of the appellee, is appropriate. And the reason it is because, as this court has consistently held, under Ohio Revised Code Section 1303.31, a negotiable instrument may only be enforced unless it's lost by proving to the court, proving in evidence at trial, or in the case of summary judgment by way of affidavit or deposition testimony, that the party seeking to enforce the note, in this case the appellee, was in possession of that note. Even though the note, even assuming that the allonge attached to the note, which is suspicious in nature because of the filing in 2008 of a foreclosure case with a note without that allonge, but even if the allonge was valid and says what it says, the obligation was on the appellee to put evidence in front of the court, evidentiary quality evidence, admissible evidence, not hearsay, that they had possession of the note at the time they moved to enforce the note. And the affidavit of Ms. Burke, that is the subject of our brief, clearly shows that it's not. Because the order of appeal, this case is like many others during the heart of the foreclosure crisis, litigants being represented by unresponsive or less than qualified counsel, resulting in situations like this unopposed motion for summary judgment. So even if you are inclined to consider the argument of the appellee that because it was the summary judgment motion was unopposed, that the challenge to the evidence shouldn't be considered at this point in time, it is so deficient relative to the court's findings in Moya, in Villalba, in the line of cases regarding what is sufficient affidavit evidence to prove the right to enforce a note in a foreclosure case. It is so deficient relative to those that I think the court could easily find that it's plain error as well. The doctrine of plain error, I understand, must be limited to exceptional cases which require its application to prevent a manifest miscarriage of justice, and where the error complained of, if uncorrected, would leave a materially adverse effect on the character of and the public confidence in the judicial proceedings. This Court of Appeals, among all 12, has done made an incredible effort through the foreclosure crisis to require that evidence presented in foreclosure cases meet the same standards of evidence that's presented in other kinds of cases. I can tell you, because we've argued cases in all 12 judicial districts in the state, that the decision of this court not to treat these cases as redheaded stepchildren, but to treat them instead as real cases involving real people and their interests, and requiring folks like the appellee in this case to provide real evidence of their right to enforce the note, and evidence that's admissible, evidence that's not hearsay, evidence that doesn't gloss over Rule 8036 and the rules of evidence in terms of submission of business records. And this is another case in that line where the court can continue that effort. May it please the court, I have no further argument at this time, and I reserve my remaining time for rebuttal.
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors.
Good morning.
I'm going to write down my time. May it please the court, I'm Barbara Friedman-Yaksik, and I represent the appellee Wells Fargo as trustee. Responding first to the brief issues that Mr. Dan raised, I apologize if my notice of supplemental authority did not comply with the rules. One of the cases just came out last week from the Ninth District, and because it was filed so close to the date of argument, I put a sentence in afterwards. Obviously, I think if you want to just strike those sentences, I think that would be the better way, but obviously that's within the court's discretion. As to whether it's a final appealable order because of the amended complaint, the denial, I filed a motion to strike that amended complaint, and that was granted. That has not been appealed. Therefore, I would argue that the time has passed for that issue to be
strike the amended answer, you mean?
Yes, the amended answer. All the amended complaint did was add one party that prior counsel had failed to name as a defendant, a lien holder. As the trial court noted, it didn't change anything else with respect to any of the other parties. It was just one lien holder had been inadvertently omitted, and I did not want to leave that unaddressed. Then turning to the issues on appeal, which I guess is also an interesting argument, I would just like to highlight a couple of facts. It is a convoluted history here. After the foreclosure action was filed, Ms. Russell's attorney did file an answer and asserted absolutely no affirmative defenses. In response to the summary judgment motion, that counsel did not contest the quality of the evidence, nor did she file an opposition. Mr. Danis pointed out that maybe that attorney was unqualified. Well, the remedy for that is a malpractice claim, not an appeal this long after the fact on issues that were not preserved below. There were then two Rule 60B motions Again, neither of those were appealed. One was filed 1 week later, and the trial court denied that because there was no meritorious defense and the grounds that one of the 60B, 1 through 5 grounds had not been stated. With respect to the second Rule 60 motion to vacate, which was filed the following year, there was no explanation for the reason for delay. There was no newly discovered facts. There was no new case law. It was just some new arguments that the new counsel had found. So what we have here is an appeal of the summary judgment motion only. The case before the court is an example of a borrower that has failed to live up to her obligations under the loan for more than 6 years. It'll be 6 years in February. It's never been any evidence below that she did make her payments before, or did fail to make her payments. In response, there have been a series of a number of different arguments to try to allow borrower to avoid her obligations. They have been based, those arguments have been based on case law that has been reversed by the Ohio Supreme Court, issues that were not raised below and are not preserved below, and by evidence which itself is not Rule 56 quality evidence.
Counsel.
Sure.
I understand what you're saying, that, you know, it sounds egregious on its face that somebody hasn't paid a mortgage in 6 years. But I don't think you're trying to convince this court that a property owner is not entitled to the requisite due process, how
Absolutely.
Long that takes.
Absolutely not, Your
so,
Honor.
So, I mean, although I understand that you have to stand up here and say they haven't paid in 6 years, is that really relevant? If the bank or the mortgage holder, whoever, hasn't adequately done their job in order to enforce the, for whatever reason, the law hasn't done the job that's necessary.
That is true, but it's just as much an obligation on the borrower and her counsel to properly defend herself, and if she does not, she cannot raise issues that were not preserved below and cannot, after the fact, submit evidence that's not Rule 56 quality evidence. So turning to that, as this court has noted on numerous occasions, when you do not object to the summary judgment evidence or do not even oppose the summary judgment, any new issues are waived. And I would cite the court to its Christie decision, which held review based on materials. The trial court, the appellate court reviews based on the materials the trial court reviewed. The James decision, that there was no evidence in opposition to summary judgment, so no subsequent evidence can be.
But isn't that after you've met your threshold burden? You don't have to, on summary judgment, obviously, the non-moving party doesn't even have to reply. That's an awful risk. But unless the moving party has met the requisite burden, there's not even the duty to reply.
That's true. But what happened here is they are now, after the fact, seeking to contest the summary judgment motion with evidence that was not submitted before. So though that evidence
should not... And that's a different issue, obviously.
Yes. And that's the issue that I am making right now. And I would also add the Elia case and the Rose case, which is out of the 7th District. I would also point out that you can't raise issues on appeal for the first time, which I'm sure the court is well aware. Mr. Dan referred to the argument that there was not possession of the note. That was not an argument raised in either of the Rule 60B motions, or I believe in this brief, and the fact that the plain error doctrine, this is the first time I've heard of that. You cannot... Due process requires fairness to all parties to the case, and so you cannot raise an issue for the first time on appeal, and I would refer to the Harris, Roberts, and Trescosco decisions, and in particular, Trescosco says you can't raise an issue on appeal when you could have raised it in the trial court. So some of those issues would be that have been raised for the very first time on appeal at no time below, is that the assignment of mortgage was invalid because there were no name change or merger documents, that there were certain documents not attached to the affidavit. Those were not raised below, so they cannot be considered here. Looking at the evidence, the other evidence, and I'm using air quotes here, Mr. Dan referred to the fact that a note without the Allonge could have been fabricated and referenced a 2008 foreclosure action. However, as Judge Hensel read it, held in the Savoy Codes, you cannot take judicial notice of prior proceedings, even if the same parties were involved, and there were not the same parties. That action was brought by the prior holder of this loan. There was no other identification of that prior note in accordance with Rule 56, so that can't be considered by the court. The assignment of mortgage has also been attacked, again, based on a statement in a Louisiana bankruptcy case. Again, that's not a proceeding before this in this case, so it cannot be judicially noticed. And there was no affidavit authenticating that document. And I would also point out, as this court held with, I think, this exact same panel in the Bayview decision, that a borrower has no standing to object to an assignment of mortgage because they are not a party to that mortgage. So therefore, that cannot be objected to. The cases cited by Ms. Russell in her brief are there before the decisions of the Supreme Court addressing some of these issues are very factually distinguishable. For example, many of them, they did, there was summary judgment opposition. With respect to the affidavit, I would submit that the affidavit submitted in this case was sufficient and refer the court to the decisions of Bayview, again by this entire panel, Beach, Freundson, James, and Villalba, and I would particularly refer to Judge Hensel's concurrence in that opinion. We note that you can infer from the statements in the affidavit there is sufficient personal knowledge. They were qualified as business records, and there was no dispute here that we had a recorded mortgage and assignment of mortgage, both dated before the date the lawsuit was filed, and both were submitted in connection with the summary judgment of motion. Therefore, for the reasons I've discussed and outlined in my brief, I would respectfully request that the summary judgment decision be affirmed and that appellant not be given a third or fourth or fifth bite of the apple, whatever we are on now. Thank you.
Thank you, Pat.
Thank you, Your Honors. It is apple season, so if you choose to give us another bite at the apple, that would be consistent with the harvest that just completed for apples, but I do understand. I understand, Your Honors, that due process of law can be inconvenient. And as I mentioned in my beginning presentation, this court has been particularly courageous in standing up to that instinct that courts across the state, across the country have felt when it related to these kind of cases. Ms. Yasek and I agree on more probably than we disagree about. Where the focus, I think, on the summary judgment issue to us is that the proof that was presented, despite the fact that it was uncontroverted, did not establish with admissible evidence that the right to the possession of the note, which is essential under the revised code to enforce the note, unless the note is lost. And nobody's made the allegation in this case that the note was lost. They're claiming they had the note, but there is zero evidence in front of the court in the affidavit that was presented in support of this motion for summary judgment that there was possession. Without possession, there's no right to enforce. And I'm not challenging, and I agree with Ms. Yatsik about standing. Standing was obtained because there was an assignment of the mortgage. So the standing exists. We're not challenging the standing, which as it relates to the summary judgment, we're challenging the sufficiency of the evidence of the right to enforce the note, the sufficiency of whether or not it was established that that the plaintiff in the case, not Aquin, not the signer of the affidavit, who never testified that she compared the note to the note to a copy that was in the file or any other record, nor did she attach any records from the files of the servicer to the affidavit. That's where I believe the rubber meets the road as it relates to the summary judgment. I'd also ask the court to take a moment to consider the procedural posture of the case. It is complicated, but due process is also important. And the right to raise those issues. We might not ever have had to come back here had Judge Gallagher allowed the amended complaint and required the plaintiff to proceed to proof on all the elements of the complaint and to address the defenses that we had hoped to raise by way of the answer to the amended complaint. With that, Your Honors, I hope you'll consider reversing and remanding this matter for further proceedings.
Counsel, I just had a couple questions. One is in regard to, basically their whole argument, you've waived everything. And what is your response to that?
My response to that is that there's still a modicum of due process of law, that the Drescher standard, as you pointed out, has never been met in this case. If you're not holding the note, you don't have the right to enforce it, no matter what it says, unless it's for some reason it's lost. And so the burden never shifted, and so even if it wasn't raised in response to a motion for summary judgment, the court can still find, either by way of plain error, or by way of their your de novo review of the summary judgment.
Okay, then the second question I had for you is, I do not see plain error raised in your brief. So you're arguing plain error today. How can we consider that when it wasn't raised in the brief? Because she is exactly right. And due process works both ways.
I don't disagree with that recitation of the facts. I do believe that, to be honest with you, it's on me. If my firm had raised that, we should have raised the issues related to the procedural issues. I think there's plain error related to that all over the record below. And I take responsibility for not being in the brief, and I felt obligated to at least raise it today. And I believe the court can sua sponte identify plain error. And this court actually has in the past.
Thank you. The only other thing I wanted to mention is in regard to the supplemental authority, they go back and look at it. And it looks like there are just some parentheticals in each of the cases as to what the appellee considers the holding to be. So when you reply, that's all we want to see.
It's all I was hoping for, Your Honor.
Okay.
Thank
all
you.
Right.